He's himself an advocate who looks at primary education, tries to improve it with hands-on suggestions and programs. We have Sanjay Gupta, who is the CEO of English Helper, that uses technology to try and empower learning, reading, writing, speaking skills. And that in today's day and age is very pertinent to how education might be. And we have Vidya Shah, Executive Director of EduGive Foundation. She and Sanjay have both a lot of experience in the corporate world as well, in senior positions. And Vidya is now managing the giving rather than the generating of money. And so we'll see what she thinks about some of the ideas that come up. We'd like to limit our discussion to about 30 minutes total, so that we have about 20 minutes of Q&A with the audience. Yeah. We're probably starting a little bit late. So we'll keep our comments brief and keep the discussion moving. So Rohit, can you kind of help us get started? You have so much experience hands-on as a teacher, and now as a teacher of teachers, you've reflected on the challenges. Your ideas on alternative education are quite radical in the scheme of things. Children need not come to school. If they are motivated, they'll come, and so on and so forth. I don't want to take the steam out of your comments, but would you like to share a bit more? Can you please turn the lights down? Thank you. Can you say a bit more about your ideas?
Good afternoon, friends. I have a bit of an identity crisis, actually, these days. For last about 5-6 years, I do not know whether I am an education activist and primary school teacher or a university teacher. So today I am speaking as a primary school teacher, more from that perspective, because about 25 years of my life I spent on that. You see, way back when we started our school in 78, called the Gandha, and then after about 10 years, when we wanted to sort of start 5-6 schools in rural area, we realized something, that education is much more than just 3 hours. And if I quote Dewey, then perhaps education could be described as forming dispositions, intellectual dispositions, and moral dispositions to the natural world and the fellow human beings. Now, this task involves a reasonable understanding of the natural world, how our surroundings function, and the society, and does require a moral code. Then only a person perhaps can be independent in thought and action. So if one starts thinking about education in this manner, then it seems that teacher becomes very important. And this is how I would like to think, that educating as it should be should involve centrally. So for this kind of teaching, then, it seems that the teacher becomes a very important key piece. Everyone says that these days. Everyone agrees to that quite easily. But the issue is that this means, basically, when you unpack this idea, that the place of a human being in the society, how am I related with the society, how am I situated in it, place of education in an individual human being's life, knowledge of school subjects, understanding of learning and the child's mind, and moral commitment to helping the child. Now, I'm just mentioning a few things at this moment because I have to be very brief. Now, my problem in this thing is that in last about 40 years, you can say after late 60s, it seems that all our innovations, all our reform initiatives have been working against this idea of a teacher who can think, who understands, and who can run the school independently. Right from the NFE days, non-formal education days, the idea has been that anyone who can read and write, and I can give about 10 days training, can go out and do education for children. This is very interesting. This is some kind of spell this idea has cast on our eyes, that in spite of repeated failure of 50 years of all these thin schemes, we go after these schemes. So that's something to do with our national mind, it seems to me. And I do not understand why. I understand why government wants that, because you don't have to pay too much money. You think that you can scale up in about 10 days. You can solve the problem in about next 2 months. And therefore, this is very attractive to the government. But they repeatedly fail. Now, my idea basically then is that rather than paying, of course, too. So we have been paying attention to the system, but we seem to be forgetting the individual as a teacher who becomes a capable person committed to education and does education. Can we rebalance our educational ideas, educational schemes and plans in such a manner that the system provides the space, but we pay much more attention to the capability and quality of the teacher? That seems to be the only way to come out of the kind of situation we are. Thank you very much.
That's perfectly fine. That's an interesting talk, the centrality of the teacher and the training the teacher might receive. Madhavji, can you comment on that?
So, it's a good thing I'm sitting so far away from Rohit, because we tend to disagree a lot. No, actually, first let me say that I absolutely agree that an ideal school or a good school requires good teachers, and investing in creating good teachers is extremely important, and it has to be done. Now that way, I can declare that Rohit and I are friends. The problem is, I mean, whether government wants to pay or not is a separate issue. I'll keep that completely out. The problem is that this system has been failing for a variety of reasons. Whether the ruling classes want good education for the poor or not, and there's many things that could be discussed. But let's leave those aside for the moment and start thinking what else is happening. And I would like to present this simple thing. And I felt that when I was growing up as well, that I was learning little in the school. It was the fun part of the school, a little in the school in the sense in the classroom. But when my Mrs. Redker told me that you are now in charge of creating this handwritten magazine, that was the best thrill of my life. And the skills that I had learned actually went into that. My dramatics and my games and all those. So that was extremely important, but I don't know how much physics and chemistry I learned there. I used to routinely get not many marks in English for spelling errors and all that, but nobody faulted me on speaking, especially later on. Now, I was learning many things outside of the, and we didn't have radio, we didn't have television. Those days were different. Today's child, it bothers me that children from upper class or even poorer sections are spending X amount of time in school, Y amount of time with tutors, and I'm not talking about just the urban. You know, elite schools, children going to tuitions, and without exception. I can't understand why is that happening. Their day is totally crowded. Even in small villages in Bihar and West Bengal, children, government school children go to private tutors. I can't understand that. They don't go to school, but they'll go to a private tutor. So what are we doing here? Apart from this, there is something that, I forget his name, a gentleman called a third parent. Now there's a third, fourth, and a fifth parent for the television. And then beyond that, now a lot of people are getting their cell phones and smartphones and stupid phones and all that. And children are routinely learning so many more things outside, and none of that actually counts as knowledge. And this is the failure of the school system. If I learn something, I'm watching World Cup soccer, and I know Messi, I love him, I fight with my friends about who's better and all that. And that doesn't come into my understanding of the geography. And unidimensional school curriculum, in many ways, the ways we teach, I was talking to, what's the lady's name? And Ms. Ansari. Anushil. So we are trying to show children shots from the International Space Station. It's so much easier to show that a drop of water is actually round in zero gravity or microgravity. Well, it's just there, and then ask a question, why do you think that is? Of course, it's not in my backyard. Anyway, so resources have increased. When this school model was developed, the number of illiterates, even in the Western communities, were low. In India, by what census of India, 1901 was probably 6% literacy, and out of that, 1/6 or whatever were women. Now, there's so many literate and let's call them educated people. There's so much knowledge around, there's so much technology around, people are handling all kinds of things, and none of that comes back into my school. And a teacher who can do all that is impossible to find.
So I get that, but I haven't quite understood the difference in opinion with Rohit. He would say that let's empower the teacher, and the teacher is central to the system.
Last line I said was a teacher who know all this.
So you're saying a teacher can't know it all?
Never did, right. But definitely not now.
Okay.
So is teacher a collective,
yeah,
or is it a professional person? That is a question mark in me.
Okay. Rohit, you want to comment on that? Is the teacher...
Why are you starting a debate between us? I have to go to
the... Because the interest is very interesting. Thoda spark kare na.
I can say one line.
Yeah.
Teacher, collective of professionals, not collective of nincompoops.
Okay, so we probably agree that we need professionals. Sanjay, we want to take it up from there. Technology and all this mix of teacher training and nincompoops and professionals.
Yeah, no, I won't get into that debate, but I'll pick up the last line around knowledge and actually talk about technology from two perspectives. Couple of examples that are very real for us. So we work across a number of states in government schools, and I was in Punjab last month visiting schools, and in that state you have Hindi teachers, for example, teaching English. So when you put a technology platform in the classroom that enables the students to read their textbook, the effectiveness obviously of the teacher changes. There are some basic issues in our current educational infrastructure, so to speak, and I use that collectively, which can be addressed by technology. A school in Haryana, in a rural district, is well-funded, has terrific teachers who are seconded from premier institutions. And this school caters to students of background where they are first-generation literates. So when the teachers came to us and said, we'd like to use your platform in our classrooms, we were quite surprised. We said, you know, I mean, all of you know English and you're very capable. Why do you need technology? And they said, well, the thing is, we have 40 minutes with these kids. And after those 40 minutes, they have no further opportunity from a pure literacy, reading, and this particular language perspective. And if we get the help of technology in the classroom, it expands our capacity. It engages the kids, and it makes us more effective. So those are two very real.
So Sanjay, can you just quickly tell us, when you talk about a platform and your products, what is it exactly? Is something on the web? Was it a device or?
No, it's all of those things. It depends on the usage. The way we work is very simple. We try to work with the goals of minimum change. So we use the existing textbooks that are being used in the school so that we have no fight with nobody, though we wish we could. We integrate that textbook and enable the use of that technology in normal class hours by the existing teacher. So there is as minimum change as possible. But the point of technology that I wanted to pick up on was the point of knowledge. Most recent messages coming out of places like the WEF are that those kids world over who are now in primary school, 65% of those kids are going to find that they have to do jobs that don't exist today. What is it that we are educating them for? Right? And by the way, our education system was designed many years ago for a colonial purpose, right? So what is it we are educating them for? And in some sense, technology and the whole process of, it's not knowledge, it's more the question, is an integral part of what has to be for the future.
So this is the second time I've heard people talk about the colonial system, which is way back. And it seems that that ghost kind of still haunts us, that we are wasted. Really, it's a strong influence.
It's not just colonial. I'll add to that. This is a industrial revolution, early industrial revolution kind of model, where you have a kit or a raw material coming in standard one, and you have a quality control process where you chop them up and say you discard karo. You keep on discarding until you finally come and they serve so many percent will pass,
right,
and then they will go to college. The whole thing is designed for the kids to learn so that they can go to ever higher education. And if you can't, then you're chopped up.
Right.
And the funny part is, in this quality control, we suddenly realize, and the globe realized, that you can't chop off children and you have to pass them on. So what you did was kept the factory the same, right? The process is the same, except you dropped the quality control. According to that factory, I don't believe in that quality control. You did not change the processes. Only said sabko pass karo. It's like saying train se kal se aapko without ticket you can travel, no problem. Now that is playing with the model. Either you come up with a completely different way of doing the same thing, of acknowledging what children are learning. So I don't know how much time I'll get later on, but I want to just insert this: educating as it should be, why not learning as it should be? Because we're all talking child-centered processes. And everything centers not around the child, but everything else that is there. And it is the children and the parents who are going to say, my child, I want to be like this. And of course, there's a role of the government, and I agree on that. But I think if we turn the subject around and say learning as it should be, I think eyes will start opening a little bit more.
Vidya, how about you observed the scenario, as it were, for some years in many areas, not just education. In your role as CEO of the foundation, what is your view on what you've heard so far and the topic in general?
Actually, if I may be a little self-deprecatory, I think as funders and as grant makers, we tend to add more chaos to this process of thinking because we have a certain set of expectations and impact and ye hona chahiye and this and that and the other. And I think, you know, my foundation is 8 years old, and when we started out, we had the liberty of experimentation, so we did try and invest or give grants to a few early models, and a lot of the nonprofits that came to us were still very much focused on access, on building school infrastructure, especially in rural areas where schools existed, but the soft infrastructure, the teachers, the parents and communities that were a little more knowledgeable, those didn't exist. So, you know, we try to focus a lot more on what Rohit has been saying, which is the softer aspect, developing teachers, focusing, finding programs that focus on developing good teachers for the schools that they and the communities that they work in, not necessarily an ideal teacher as defined by any of us. And I think now the debate is very, very clearly moving, especially in the funding community, from access and learning outcomes to what happens to these kids when they come out. And I don't know if we're very early in the game, because we still have a lot of kids that are out of school early, a lot of kids that are not achieving the learning outcomes that we'd like them to. But nevertheless, the focus has shifted. And I think one of the great things that Asar did was really throw a mirror on the fact that I would look at it as three legs, you know, the ability, the literacy, whether you can read, write, do basic math. I think there was a huge awakening that happened as a result of all the reports and continues to happen. But as funders, we're now worrying about job readiness, some of which Sanjay spoke about, and also about, are we really developing the next generation of good citizenry? And are these the people who are really going to define the future of India, both politically, economically, socially? And as we think about that, I think two aspects are developing a lot of prominence, and those are basically skills and attitudes. and skills in terms of, not just in terms of do you have a vocation that you can convert into a job, but also do you have critical thinking, do you have the problem solving ability, which willy-nilly we found in our schools when we were growing up, because we were thrown into situations, you had to write a book, you had to handwrite it, and a lot of us were thrown into those situations, but today's schools, whether urban or rural, actually don't provide those opportunities. They don't make the connections between Messi and geography. And so those are the, you know, those are the skills that our children lack. And then the attitudes, whether it's curiosity or empathy, discipline, rigor, diligence. I mean, these are the things that will prepare a citizenry that's ready not only for the jobs, but also for the attitudes that the world is now demanding.
So you raised it, you raised some even broader concerns about citizenship and being able to handle new situations. And you know, you talked about rather one antiquated system which is not producing necessarily the kids who can do what's needed of them. And you turned it around to say that learning as it should be rather than teaching as it should be. So given the ESSER report that you mentioned, which a lot of people follow, and which you do periodically, and given your sort of experience with how things are evolving or not evolving, and given these objectives, broader objectives of what we want our citizens to have, what are the two or three things that you feel you wish would be different? Or it can be done?
ESSER is a different thing altogether. Okay. It was designed for a different purpose. It doesn't talk about the overall problem of education. It was designed for a short purpose. Now, this year, after 10 ESSERs, we've taken a break. We're looking at what else we need to do. What ESSER essentially said was everything is not fine, and which everybody knew, but we put a number to it. So many children can't read at this grade or whatever. And that was factual. It can be verified. Depends upon how you do it. But I think the bigger question is, what should we do? Good citizenship. Everybody says, and I ask people, why do you send your child to school? And they say, I want him to be a good educated person, and this, that, or the other. And that's what ostensibly all policies say as well. The problem is, if you are going to drink and engage in domestic violence at home, how is the school going to correct it unless there is a social worker, a counselor who's going to help out? And should you not be not drunk and not engage in domestic violence? And that's happening in one family. But if the entire society, is it presenting to the child a role model of citizenship? Doesn't the society have a responsibility? What are our political parties doing? Everything is on the TV these days, and the kid is actually seeing exactly what you want him to be. And then you put him in the school, push him there in the school with this brilliant teacher and say, now teach him. Mera kaam khatam ho gaya. I think we are looking at the school in an isolation. School cannot be isolated from society. Let's take that so-called African proverb seriously, and many things that Gandhiji said and all that. It takes a whole village to educate a child. The teacher is a piece of it. But everybody, including the Indian couples in the village, have to contribute to the growth of the child. And you've got to be sure that that is done. Now what is happening is education is equal to passing 10th standard, getting marks, 12th standard, getting marks. Only so many will get it. The others will say, "Pad nahi paaye bhaiya, dasti tak chale gaye." That is not right. That whole education we have not looked at. We are looking only at school, whereas the atmosphere today is such that the child is learning, educating himself or herself on the job. Learning is the most prevalent of vocational training there is. It has nothing to do with what you teach the child, because anyway you're not teaching them in the school what to do when they go on the job. And this is what most of the HR people will prefer as well, ki haath mat lagao, andar aake 3 mahine unko train karke hum kuch kara denge. Apprenticeship, although formally not approved, this is what they're doing. Entire country, in this country, entirely runs on the job training. This is a new schooling altogether. And let's look at what's happening in life and start taking lessons from it, then start saying, okay, what my school should be.
So to some extent, when you gave us your example, that when you were in school and your teacher said, go do this writing, that was almost like on the job learning. You actually have to do something.
And children love to do those things. Unfortunately, that's considered co-curricular. I mean, now if you want to teach physics and so speed and velocity and all that, you ask your children to run. The other day I tried this and everybody knew that stopwatch se hum log sabhi, we can see who's the fastest. I said, who's the fastest? They said, stopwatch. You know, karo. Then they said, so now what does the stopwatch tell you? How much did you run? Can you calculate speed? Now there was a problem. 25 meters ko kaise divide kare, kisse to division nahi aa raha. So I said, will you calculate help? Kar sakte? Now kar lo. Now they went to the phone, cell phone and did the calculator. Now they didn't know what the units were. But at least you let them move. Now there are so many different ways of doing it. And yes, a good teacher can do that. But it is going to take a lot more.
So Rohit, can we come back to you? You had, when you set up Digantha, you were actually thinking along some of these lines of let's not be thinking about targets in terms of graduation and so on. And you only had testing at a couple of points in the schools, in the child's time in the school, and you were trying to use innovative methods. And you've heard from Sanjay, today we can use technology to empower the teacher and perhaps help with learning as well. And given all the comments you've heard, and the broader social, you know, the village has to be in charge of helping the child learn, not just the teacher. What are your thoughts?
One thing I would like to say that in education, what you call, and I think in the morning session, Madhav session, I find agree myself more with what Madhav today than usual.
I mean, that really helped to bring around this approach.
Anyway, I know. So, in the morning, as he said, that the idea of replication or scale, perhaps spreading an idea, that perhaps is better than that. So, in education particularly, you cannot scale a model. That is quite impossible. The only possibility is sharing the insight and understanding you generate through your experience with the larger people who are working, and then they will make whatever they want to make of it. That kind of thing is possible. From that point of view, I would like to comment on two or three things. I think he brought in a very interesting idea that children learn so many things from the television and internet and various kind of thing, and then we also have technology, and through that they also do. You see, the thing is that we often make a mistake, and I'm sorry for sounding pedantic, we often make a mistake between information and education. Education is not about getting information. Information is one of the essential inputs in education. Education is invoking the power of mind to make judgment and act. Now, information is necessary for that, but information doesn't complete that circle. So what does the school do? School perhaps should leverage on the information which is being available in technology, etc., and should start some sort of activity and discourse within the school where that information becomes integrated part of that person's intellectual makeup. That is the job school does. And for that, you do require a kind of understanding of education in that manner. I would also say that this idea that if the society has several ills in it, and there are many families where there is drinking or whatever, you know, violence, etc., therefore, can school do something? Yes, these are problems, but these are problems in every society and different kinds of problems. The school has to work within that. That neither the idea that there are many ills and evils in family, nor the idea that there is on-the-job training builds an argument that school is irrelevant. That simply builds an argument that school should be sort of taking these things into consideration and educating in an appropriate manner. I'll say one last little thing on this. You see, In Swaraj, Gandhi writes four or three pages, I believe, on education. And he makes a claim that he says that I learned geometry, algebra, arithmetic, astronomy, geography, and several other things, and they have never been useful in my life. I don't think that is true. You may never have thought about algebra later on in your life, but the kind of shape it gives to your mind, that is with you. And therefore that Gandhi's argument, Gandhi was saying in a different context, that argument is taken by many people these days, that school mein kya sikhte hain? That the issue is not school mein information. The issue is that the way school shapes your mind, and our schools are not shaping that mind in the proper sense. And I'll come back. That's, it seems to me that school, the mind could be shaped in a proper way only by a mind which is shaped in a proper way. And that is the teacher. So,
I just want to add an obvious but additional dimension to this discussion. The survey that comes out each year tells us that more than half of our school students can't read. At grade level, definitely below grade level. And we have a problem of magnitude, which is today. We propose to skill 500 million youth by 2022. If we are able to achieve that, which I think is highly doubtful, we will have conducted the largest ever training exercise in the history of this planet, anywhere, anytime, right? This exercise is largely because we have a basic educational issue that has resulted in this problem. We have 170 million, 17 crore, 18 crore, the number varies, students in government schools. And we have a crisis today. And I think it's very important that as we look at a multiple set of elements associated with all the things we've discussed, we have to ask ourselves, how do we solve the basic problem? We've got kids who can't read. And if they can't read, they can't add. And thereafter comes everything else. Of course, the issues of society, community, our politics. Shekhar talked about the governance, which was set up for 35 crores and 160 crores. We've got a bunch of things to solve for. And that's, I think, the place we come from when we think of technology, because just to illustrate and embellish, we started what we started doing in 100 schools, covering 20,000 students. This year we're implementing across a million students, 5,000 schools in 8 states. Holistic education? Absolutely not. Getting them to read? Yes.
Well, thank you. I think obviously there are some very, very important issues here. The solutions are not easy at all. But I hope the conversation here has stimulated some new thinking in you. And we can always carry these conversations offline after this session. So thank you very much, everybody, for your participation.